Hello everyone, happy Storytelling Day and welcome to the second virtual edition of SheThePeople.tv's Women Writers Fest 2021. I'm going to be in conversation with Anuja Chauhan. Hi Anuja.
Hi.
Little introduction first. Anuja Chauhan worked in advertising for over 17 years and is credited with any popular campaigns, including Nothing Official About It, Ye Dil Mange More, Mera Number Ka Baega, Oi Bubbly, and Dar Ke Aage Jeet Hai. She's the author of 5 best-selling novels, The Zoya Factor, Battle for Bitora, Those Pricey Thakur Girls, The House That BJ Built, Baz, and her latest, Club You to Death. Welcome, Anuja. You are an incredibly successful author of rom-coms. Considering you have an established readership that expects more of the same, okay, were you apprehensive or worried about shifting to a whodunit, which you call a bloody good romance? Was it also the effect of the lockdown?
Yes, I did say that the lockdown made me want to murder people. So maybe I was just getting into my violent impulses. But more seriously, I think that with every book, there's a little pressure, you know? I mean, every time the first book, nobody knows. The excitement is just about being published, you know? So that's a big deal that you're a published author, you wrote a book. Then with every subsequent book, I think the pressure that you put on yourself and grows a little because, you know, you don't want that your first book is a hit and then everything else is a disaster. So the idea is to keep trying to grow, not get boxed into a particular little formula or whatever. Just the whole thing of a creative journey and hoping to get better with each work and build up like a nice shelf full of books perhaps by the time you're ready to quit the planet. So I think with every book, it's the same thing. You want to write something that shows your growth as a writer, the more experiences that you're having, you're getting older, you're maturing. Similarly, your writing should also mature similarly.
Okay. So you don't believe that the author should stick to a tried and tested genre?
No, because I think that's... I'm just saying that... rather than tried and tested, you should keep testing yourself and you should like keep pushing a little, you know. I mean, I believe in balance. There is something that works and that you should hang on to and not throw the baby out of the bathwater. But at the same time, there also needs to be growth and freshness because at the end of the day, the reason why people picked up your first book was because it was so fresh. And now as you keep getting older, as somebody who has read, then you need to retain freshness while also keeping up, you know, the craft and other things like that. So,
okay. Your book is set in the heart of Lutyens, the posh Delhi locality that you're so familiar with. And you've spent your childhood in various cantonment towns and have fond memories of clubbing. Does writing about what you know a tad easier than exploring the unknown? Just because you're in familiar ground?
The thing is that I think that everybody's personal experiences are their raw data. Things that have happened to you in the first person is actually your best, most richest, most individual source. Everything else could be stuff that you've either heard or stuff that you have seen or read, right? So your individual experiences are your richest source of inspiration. They are what is going to make you unique. Your experiences are unique and that's your best source. So I would always go back to something that I'm familiar with, that I know the ins and outs of, that I know the negatives and the positives, that I don't have rose tinted glasses about. So I always like to do a deep dive into a subject. And if I already have access to that subject, then it becomes easier. And I can write with more authenticity and more authority, more affection and more criticism from an insider's voice than I can write about a topic that I don't know anything about.
Okay. Club You to Death touches upon people in privilege, caste, class, social hierarchies, hypocrisies, just as your earlier books examined toxic patriotism, surgical strikes, blind faith or superstition. Do you feel duty-bound or pressurized by expectations to address the churn in society, the way things are happening now? Do you feel pressured as an author that I must write about this?
I don't feel pressured, but somehow I feel compelled. I want to write about these things, you know? So it comes from within. It's not something artificially put on top. And I really do feel that Nobody falls in love in a vacuum, right? You're falling in love in the middle of all kinds of issues that are being hotly debated. There is a larger structure inside which you are placed, even if you are falling in love or even if you are solving a murder mystery. There is all this stuff going around you. And I think that if you put a character into his setting, and you can't just drop him into a setting. He has to be woven into the setting. He has to be part of it. And this is the setting that exists nowadays. So it also helps, I think, as a for a reader, you get a better grasp of the character. You're like, okay, this is this guy's take on this. This is this girl's take on this. And it just helps the reader get familiar and acquainted with your character if they know what their viewpoints are ideologically, politically, romantically, spiritually. It's just good to know what people's takes on issues are. Because isn't that how we, even if we meet new people nowadays, don't we sort of figure them out on the basis of what their take is on all kinds of issues of the day?
Yes. Your stories have made it from book to screens, films, television, and OTT platforms. When you write a book, are you conscious of the possibilities of its journey? Does it give an edge to your creativity, or does it hamper it?
I think that because I've written advertising scripts, I've worked in advertising full time for 17 years.
Yes.
So I think that I have been trained to think along these three XYZ axes of the visual, the dialogue, and the background score. You know, so when I write, I end up giving out hints about what the background sound is, you know, where the scene is set, what is being seen visually, and also what people are speaking. So that's just my training. Because when I write, I have been trained, and what I like to do is make a movie play out in your head. You know, when you're reading the book, there's a movie playing in your head. That is the movie that I've written. Now, if somebody thinks that that is something that they should make into an actual movie or into an actual OTT, that's very exciting. But that is not my goal. My goal is that my reader should see a movie in the head when they're reading the book.
So you are on autopilot mostly.
Sorry?
You are on autopilot because you are already trained to think that way when you write. It's a part of your DNA.
That's how I write. That's my style, yes.
And you had said earlier that if OTT platforms were around in, say, 2006, you may not have written any of your books. Why did you say that? And what is it about this medium that excites you?
What's exciting about, these platforms is that there is an opportunity to put in layers, right? You're not just stuck into a two-hour format for a film or, you know, that you're not bound by the screenplay, you're not bound by the time durations and everything. You can write many seasons, many layers, many characters, allow for growth of each character. And so it's just more layered than writing for a film, perhaps. So that's why. I mean, I'm quite, of course, I must have said that at a very honeymoon phase. And now, of course, we have so much censorship and so much politics creeping into OTT platforms as well. And there seems to be too many of them, perhaps. And, you know, I think that little bit, that honeymoon phase is over slightly.
So let's switch gears a bit. It's 2021 and we are still stereotyping women. One, do you agree? Patriarchy is a bogeyman that doesn't seem to go away. And have you ever been a victim of this? Can you elaborate?
See, I don't think patriarchy, the roots are so deep spread. It's not like we can all just say, yeah, and then we'll give it one good yank and we'll pull it out and patriarchy is finished. You know, it's not that kind of dragon that you can slay like that. The roots are really deep and it is like a hydra. It has so many heads, you chop down one, ten come up, all that. So it's not something that you can hope to defeat overnight. So obviously, that doesn't mean that you don't even bother trying, you know. So you do bother trying and you keep bashing away at the windmills on a daily basis. We all do it. As far as being a victim of patriarchy is concerned, we are all victims of patriarchy. In every it happens around. It's so internalized that you don't even realize it, you know. In every sort of setting, it exists. We've had, because of the lockdown, we've had all these debates about, you know, sharing the workload at home, the fact that a man will cook one meal and he'll put out the picture on Instagram, everyone will say, wow, what a guy, he cooked a meal. Oh my God, amazing. And you know, if a man has changed a diaper, people are willing to give him a Padma Shri for changing a diaper only. This is ridiculous, right? And nobody is giving a woman a Padma Shri for getting a job. That is considered that, yeah, you do everything because you're a goddess and you have 12 hands and so everything. So I just think that we are all victims of it. Men as much as women are victims of the patriarchy. You know, fact that the boy is a sissy. If a boy has a good relationship with his mother, then he's a mama's boy. If a boy is, you know, a boy mustn't cry and a boy must always earn more than a girl and a boy must know without being told what the girl wants, you know, in a romantic slash sexual situation. There's a lot of pressure. Everybody's a victim. So I think this is a war we all need to fight together.
So have you also been stereotyped? How did you deal with it?
We're dealing with it on a constant basis. I mean, it's there, it's everywhere, it's all the time. You know, every time you're getting dressed to go out and you're wondering, oh, should I wear this? But it's backless. But I'm 50 years old. What will people think? That is also like it's there all the time. We are constantly fighting ageism, sexism, all kinds of reasons all the time. There are different rules for older women. There are different rules for older men. There is the fact that how will you stay relevant once you cross the magical sexually attractive figure of 35 years, you know, why are you even alive? Like, you're done, you procreated, and your best years looks wise are behind you. So why you're just a waste of space? I mean, that is the kind of attitude people have towards older women, and they become invisible as they grow older. So there is all that. Whereas a man can hang around, he can still play a leading role in a movie at the age of 55 or whatever. So it's just all pervasive. I don't think, see, the idea is not to make the genders into enemies of each other. It's not men against women. Yes. It is supposed to be men and women. We have to fight this together. So I'm really against anything that pitches us against each other and creates a more unloving world. You know, so that kind of thing I'm not into. I'm clearly a feminist. Everyone should be a feminist. But like I said, it's everyone has to be a feminist. We are all in this together and we should fight it together.
Well, when women speak their minds, why do you think they're called bitches? And women supposedly cannot be outspoken and get away with it. What do you have to say about it? Because this is muffling voices. Sorry, this is muffling voices, you know?
Yeah, of course it is. It is. It's just a sad truth of the world that when a woman speaks up, she's a bitch. When a man speaks up, he's a tiger. People are not comfortable with women in authority. They're much more comfortable with men. We need to, all of us need to worry less about being liked. You know, women are always under pressure to be liked. Sabko saath leke chalo. Don't antagonize anyone. Be the voice of reason in the room. Why are so many women working in human resources? You know, for this same reason. Because there also they made you into some kind of, you know, mummy ji and all that. So why? Okay. You know, I'm just saying that there's this. And I think this is our fault. We need to stop frantically trying to please everybody. I want to please my boss. I want everyone to like me. I want my mother-in-law to like me. I want my daughter's class teacher to like me. Why are you so worried about this? I mean, honestly, if we stopped worrying so much about being liked, we would be much happier. And we would be much more successful and much more unapologetic. And in India, honestly, I feel that beyond a point, men are very happy to worship women or give them an odha. Because I think, you know, we have like our goddesses, we have Kali, we have Durga, we have politically, we have Indira Gandhi, we have Mamata Banerjee, we have all these amazing female role models. And I think somewhere men, after a certain point, are comfortable with like Mata Devi figures in their life. But we don't, I think this is a woman thing, you know, I mean, like we're just like really obsessed with. We want people to like us rather than people to respect us. We should be reaching out for respect. We should not be reaching out for appeasement or liking.
How true. Yes. We're supposedly a woke generation, yet trial by media is a regular occurrence. Cancel culture rules. You target a person and try to wipe that person out. So could this be the biggest issue of today's generation? What do you think?
I think now cancel culture is in the way of being cancelled itself only.
You know, really? I mean, are you that optimistic? Okay.
No, I mean, I think that, no, yeah, what, you know, because like, if the point is that public memory is so short, right? Tomorrow there'll be one more thing, and then the fact that you got cancelled yesterday, everyone will forget by day after tomorrow. So I would just look at that a little optimistically. And you know, like how people say life is short. Life is not short. Life is long. There are many innings. There are many laps. You can keep coming back. You can be relevant again. You can, people like this, the second coming, the third coming, the fourth coming of politicians, of actors, even actresses today, right? People keep coming back and you're saying, oh, look who's back, who's been confirmed for a fourth season, fifth season. So I think the phrase cancel culture is like an exciting phrase that people have now really got into. But I don't think that, I think you can always come back and have another bash. Look at Monica Lewinsky, for example, having an amazing new innings in this time. You know, that is like the ultimate person who was ultimately cancelled. And she's so relevant, she's so loved, people are listening. So I think that, so yeah, like I said, cancel culture is being cancelled.
You have honed the art of creating memorable characters. What, apart from strong character arcs, makes people hang in there? What makes a narrative compelling?
Sorry, I'm just still going back to your old question when you were talking about...
Yeah,
you know, like, I mean, if you think about people, there's this whole thing of, like you say, for example, that Tanish cat, you know, or even the series Tanda that came out, or now again, now Bombay Begums is facing the same thing. People are trying to shut you down constantly, and I think you need to fight that. So I think that when Tanish puts out an ad which is trying to say something which is a common truth and which is enshrined in our constitution, and people hit out at them, I think it's very wrong for them to be scared by the fact that somebody's trying to cancel what they're saying, and that they should stick to their guns and fight it out. Because if you can't stick to your guns and fight it out, then don't do it to begin with. I think you do a bigger disservice when you panic and you blink and you sort of let down everybody when you do something like that, you know. So if you're planning to take a bold stance, then please stick to your bold stance, because then you contribute to everybody being so scared and nobody being able to speak up about anything at all.
That is how it pretty much is right now, right? I mean, it's very difficult in these times. Very tough.
Yeah, it is. But it's very important to stick to your guns now, because if you, otherwise it's more important than it ever was.
Switching gears again. So back to that question about how you've honed the art of creating memorable characters, and what, apart from strong character arcs, makes people hang in there? Because you've always talked about how it's important to make people hang in there. So what makes a narrative compelling?
I think there needs to be like one thread. Now we're talking really, this is a mathematical kind of conversation, right? Now we're talking like the not
just
very...
some insights, yes.
Yeah,
no, sure. Just some insights. Because you're an amazing storyteller.
Yeah, so what I would say to this is that what people makes hang in there is you write about, you create characters that people care about. You create characters that people are rooting for, or people are hating aggressively. And then you take them to a place where you put them in an interesting narrative, and then people are hanging in there to see it ends. So in a typical romance structure, you're hanging there to see these two people get together, you know, or implode or whatever it is. You want to see what you created to people that everyone cares about, and you're hanging in there to see what happens to them. And I think nowadays people have such short attention spans, and there's so many things always constantly competing for your attention, that you need to have a simple structure like that, where people are staying with the book to say, are these two going to get together? Similarly, in a whodunit format, it's the same thing. People are hanging in there to find out who done it, right? And why done it? And how done it? So I think that just helps a book retain a reader's attention in these very... fickle sort of times.
You have spoken about reading a lot of Agatha Christie, and obviously the inspiration behind your thriller. And who are the other authors that have impacted your writing, and where do you source your stories from?
I don't particularly like thrillers. I haven't written a thriller, you know, so it is not, when you say thriller, I imagine blood and gore and sexy men and, you know, dark, gritty themes. It's not like that. I think the genre that I'm going for is called cozy crime, which is like a book with a lot of suspense, which you read with a cup of hot chocolate next to a fire on a winter evening, or, you know, on a monsoon day or something. It's that kind of zone. I love reading those kind of books. To me, Agatha Christie is queen of that genre. There are various other people who write as well. She does in different ways. There's the Father Brown series. There is Rumpole of the Bailey. In that same zone, there's you know, Nio Marsh and Dorothy Sayers. And these are the kind of books that I like reading. These are the kind of shows that I like watching. I used to watch with my mother. So it's just that I'm writing with a lot of affection and a lot of homage to the genre when I wrote this book.
You relocated to the outskirts of Bangalore to a calmer milieu, imagining yourself as being a nighty person who spent her days writing books that she had complete control over inside her cave. Has it panned out as planned? And
Yes,
what's changed for you as a writer?
it's panned out brilliantly.
It has.
I'm really very
The fact
happy.
that
Yes. It's so, I feel very blessed that I'm writing and people are reading, and so I can afford to have this kind of life, you know, where I get to sit in my garden and write all day and have cups of tea in the morning and, you know, glasses of wine in the evening and just write. And I'm very thankful and happy about this existence for sure.
Now, do you see ACP Bhavani Singh, the genial old school crime branch veteran who is appointed to investigate the murder in Club You to Death, becoming a sort of cult figure? Will we see more of him?
I don't know about that, but he's getting a lot of love. AC Bhavani, a lot of the reviews have talked very, I mean, everybody seems, not everybody, but a lot of people seem to be liking him. And I've got a lot of interest from various studios in Bombay who are all very interested in AC Bhavani. So that's exciting and very encouraging. And I would definitely want to write more books and put him in more situations for sure.
Wonderful. You've managed to conquer most of the dragons that writers face, including shunning labels. What insights can you share with aspiring writers, and how does one make it as a successful author in these super woke times? डर के आगे क्या क्या करें?
नहीं, आई थिंक
लोगों को बहुत
दैट
डर लगता है.
हाँ नहीं, आई थिंक व्हाट यू हैव टू डू इज दैट यू हैव टू राइट, यू हैव टू शट आउट एवरी, यू कांट, ये सब घुसने का, देयर इज नो पॉइंट गेटिंग इनटू हु विल गेट ऑफेंडेड बाय व्हाट यू रोट. एंड व्हेन यू आर राइटिंग, कीप योर राइटिंग प्रोसेस रियली प्योर. डोंट गेट ऑब्सेस्ड विद ओ व्हाट विल पीपल से एंड यू नो हाउ विल दिस गो डाउन एंड विल माय बुक बी बर्नड और विल माय इन लॉज बी ऑफेंडेड और यू नो व्हाटएवर इट इज दैट्स, विल माय बॉस सैक मी बिकॉज़ आई did this or whatever it is. You can't write with a sense of audience. If you write with a sense of audience, you'll cripple yourself. For example, if you're typing on your laptop and somebody comes and stands behind you, then you'll shut your laptop. You know, you'll say, yeah, you're don't read. So that is a sense of audience, you know, and a sense of audience always cripples you. Like they say, dance like no one's watching, you know, and sing like no one's listening. So write like no one's reading. You know, just write your purest thing and write every day. Try and write 1,000 words a day. One way or the other, at the end of a year, you'll have a full book, you know. So eventually, it's not dar ke aage jeet hai here. I think it's just persistence ke aage jeet hai. You know, lage raho munna bhai type of thing. Yeah.
Oh, wonderful. Do you have daily rituals like journaling or taking long walks that facilitate reflection and give impetus to the writing process? Because a lot of these aspiring writers want to know what writers do. Some of them says, "Oh, Anuja sits cross-legged." How does that, help better creativity or have?
No, my whole life I've always sat as comfortably as possible. For me, comfort is the most important. Like, wear comfortable clothes and sit comfortably, because if you're not comfortable, then you're not going to be able to speak properly, write properly. So for me, that comfort is very important. You know, as it far as daily rituals do go, I do two things every day without fail. I mean, not every day. One thing I do every day, which is I feed the puppies, you know, so I walk out and I feed the stray dogs in my neighborhood morning and evening. That is something I do every day. And thrice a week, I work out. I go for my Zumba class and my mixed martial arts and my kickboxing and Kalaripattu. So that's really important to me as well. So
the writers
I think
have to be fit.
Everyone has to be fit, yeah. Not just writers. Like bankers have to be fit.
बैठते रहते हैं ना, बैठते रहते हैं एक जगह. So
हाँ, बैठते रहते हैं तो सही बात है.
मिडिलमैन
से मेरे को बहुत घबराहट होती है. कोई भी मिडिलमैन, whether it's someone with a big tika or it's someone in a long white choga or it is somebody in some, you know, some molvi nerve. I am very frightened of middlemen. I'm very frightened of people who claim a higher moral authority coming straight from, you know, a power that nobody can ask them any questions and all. So mujhe bahut ghabrahat hoti hai from any kind of bicholia. I don't like middle people. So I'm saying you have a relation. Have a relationship directly with your creator, and you, when you get a good idea, whenever some good line of dialogue comes, I'm immediately like, thank you, thank you, thank you, you know, because it's coming from there. It's coming from the same person who's designed sunflowers and puppies, and you know, I'm always in great admiration of that and very happy to be part of that grander scheme or whatever. So I know that anything rubbish that I write is coming from me, and anything inspired or worthy or, you know, funny, even like just pure fun, is coming from the universe. So that's it. And I don't like, I have huge suspicion of organized religion.
Okay. What is going to come next? Tell us about it.
Okay. So I'm excited. I have just started writing a commissioned movie screenplay for Ad Labs, and I have a new movie releasing this summer, which I've written for. It's called Sardar Ka Grandson. It's starring Nina Gupta, Arjun Kapoor, John Abraham, and a bunch of really talented ensemble cast. And that comes out this summer on Netflix. And Those Spicy Thakur Girls is being made into a series by Disney Hotstar. And that's being shot as we speak and directed by Habib Faisal, who's amazingly talented and has worked very hard on the screenplay. I think they spent a year just writing and everything. And I think KCP Bhavani is going down well. So definitely another book for them.
Wonderful. Thanks, Anuja. Thanks a ton for your time. And thank you for being with She the People.